Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of good will. The 14th verse of the second chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Dear children of God, my sermon this morning will be a very short one. I only wish that you should meditate in your hearts the deep meaning and mystery of our Mass of Christmas Day. For in the same moment that we celebrate the birth of our Lord, we shall be reenacting his passion and death. In the same moment that we rejoice in his coming for the salvation of men, we shall offer again to God his body and blood in sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world. It was in this same night that has just passed that a multitude of the heavenly host appeared before the shepherds of Bethlehem, saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men of good will. At this same time then of all the year that we celebrate at once the birth of our Lord and his passion and death upon the cross. Beloved, as the world sees, this is to behave in a strange fashion. For who in the world will both mourn and rejoice at once and for the same reason? For either joy will be overborne by mourning, or mourning will be cast out by joy. So then, it is only in these our Christian mysteries that we can rejoice and mourn at once and for the same reason. But think for a while on the meaning of this word, peace. Does it seem strange to you that the angels should have announced peace when ceaselessly the world has been stricken with war and the fear of war? Does it seem to you that the angelic voices were mistaken, and that the promise was a disappointment and a cheat? Reflect now how our Lord himself spoke of peace. He said to his disciples, My peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Did he mean peace as we think of it? The kingdom of England at peace with its neighbors? The barons at peace with the king, the householder counting over his peaceful gains, the swept heart, his best wine for a friend at the table, his wife singing to the children. Those men, his disciples, knew no such things. They went forth to journey afar, to suffer by land and sea, to know torture, imprisonment, disappointment, to suffer death by martyrdom. What then did he mean? If you ask that, remember then that he said also, Not as the world gives, give I unto you. So then, he gave peace to his disciples, but not as the world gives. Now consider also one thing of which I dare say you've never thought. Not only do we in this one night celebrate our Lord's birth and his death, but on the next day we celebrate the martyrdom of his first martyr, the blessed Stephen. Is it an accident, do you think, that the day of the first martyr comes immediately after the day of the birth of Christ? By no means. For just as we rejoice and mourn at once in the birth and the passion of our Lord, so also, in a smaller figure, we both rejoice and mourn in the death of martyrs. We mourn for the sins of the world that has martyred them. We rejoice that another soul is numbered among the saints in heaven for the glory of God and the salvation of men. Beloved, we do not think of a martyr simply as a good Christian who has been killed because he is a Christian, for that would be merely to mourn. We do not think of him simply as a good Christian who has been elevated to the company of the saints, for that would be simply to rejoice, And neither our mourning nor our rejoicing is as the world is. A Christian martyrdom is never an accident, for saints are not made by accident. Still less is a Christian martyrdom the effect of a man's will to become a saint, as a man, by willing and contriving, may become a ruler of men. A martyrdom is always the design of God, for his love of men, to warn them and to lead them and to bring them back to his ways. It is never the design of man. For the true martyr is he who has become the perfect instrument of God, who has lost his own will in the will of God, and who no longer desires anything for himself, not even the glory of being a martyr. So then, as on earth we both rejoice and mourn in a way that the world cannot understand, so in heaven the saints are most high, having made themselves most low, and are seen not as we see them, but in the light of the Godhead from which they draw their being. Dear children of God, I have spoken to you this morning of the saints whom we have had, asking you to remember especially our own martyr of Canterbury, the blessed Archbishop Eliot, because it is fitting on Christ's birthday that we should remember what is that peace which he brought, and because, dear children, I do not think I shall ever preach to you again, and because it is possible that in a short time you may have yet another martyr, and that one perhaps not the last. I would have you ponder these things no longer now, but at a later time. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.